test. I'm in Zion in Tammuz. Getting here for 3 weeks. So I want to take a look where we came from, where we're going to, and then what we can do in the meantime as on the ship. First, I want to thank Rev. Fairman in this moment, but the opportunity to speak. It's always worthwhile to have a course of talk to those who give you an opportunity to be Marvin's Torah. It's very important. Whatever people are comfortable with, if you want to turn it on, that's great. Yeah. Windows are closed, I guess. I can. More extra time. Thank you. So, this parsha's Pindus. It's significant that these parshas more or less come out the same way. Parsha's Pindus usually right after the Kindness and before Tisha B'Av is Devarim. Pindus is Hu Eliyahu. We know that Pindus, because of his tremendous Mesiras Nefesh, was zoyked to become Eliyahu Navi. And the Chafetz Chaim, in his Sefer Machane Yisrael, the Sefer was written for Jewish soldiers, mostly in the Jewish Russian army, he brings down the Medrash Chazal that 3 days before Mashiach is going to come, so Eliyahu Navi is going to be on Har Sinai, and he's going to be screaming for 3 days straight. He's screaming that everyone should do tshuva, because he wants people as much as possible to be zoyche to the Gula Shlema, the Bias of Mashiach. That's what we're hoping and praying for. So Eliyahu Navi is going to be sent 3 days before that to give people the one final last chance at what they can do before the final Gula, and everything's going to be more or less fixed. And then people as they are will be judged. So people will have a 3 day chance, finally, absolutely, to make a change in what they've been doing up until then. So I'm trying to think for myself and hopefully for other people as well, what can we possibly do that's going to be significant? Like, let's say those 3 days began now. What in the world can we possibly do in 3 days that would make such a dramatic change in our situation from now that we're in Golis and in Bez Hashem, say 3 days from now, be in Zman of Gula. And Zman of Gula is everyone's going to be, as I said, fixed, more or less, what you are is what you will be forever, because then the HR will be more or less taken care of. And there won't be any nisyon. This person won't have a chance to grow spiritually in the same way that we can do now. Now, as a matter of fact, the Zman of Golis is a tremendous chance for spiritual growth. Chafetz Chaim says also in another essay, Yisapi Yeshua, he says that a person who is in Golis is in a completely different situation. Obviously, then when they had a base in Mikdash, we had the Avod in the Yerushalayim and the Kohanim doing the Korbanis in the base of Mikdash. Completely different situation. What's the basic situation change? When we had all those things, Eretz Yisrael, where it used to be, we had the base of Mikdash, the Kohanim doing the Avod and the Korbanis, a person had a tremendous infrastructure, a support system for his Ruchnius, right? And with that support system for his ruchnius, he could go very far. When you have a support system, right, you can go very far. However, what happened was that during time, what occurred was a situation, as the Navi Yirmiyahu says, mitzvahs and nashim nirmad. Mitzvahs became automatic, stale in terms of what people did, and for their heart was gone from the mitzvahs. So basically, it was just basically an outer show of doing the mitzvahs, and it wasn't the panemius, the internal part, the lave, what Kadosh Baruch Hu really wants. So therefore, the external infrastructure of Ruchnius, of the Beis HaMikdash and Eretz Yisrael and everything else, lost its value, because it was just like a crutch to keep a person crawling along. And if he would lose the crutch and start working out those muscles, he would heal much faster. So without that crutch, Klal Yisrael, so to speak, would do much better. So we lost the Beis HaMikdash, we lost Eretz Yisrael, now we're in Golis. So therefore, without these, so to speak, spiritual crutches, we have to stand on our own. We have to stand on our own against all the influences of the non-Jews and the rest of the cultures and societies that we're faced with. And we can, hopefully, the purpose of Golis is to help us strengthen ourselves individually and prove to ourselves and to Akadosh Baruch Hu that we want to serve Him and absolutely only Him, truthfully, with a full lave and a full mind. And then, once we've done that, that will be the tachlis of the Golus. That will be the purpose of Golus fulfilled. And then we can have the base of Mikdash back, Eretz Israel back, Yerushalayim back, the way it all was. And those spiritual support systems will not be crutches. They will be actually be advantages in serving HaKadosh Baruch Hu, the way they should be originally. And that's the way we hope and pray that it should be. So, however, once Golus loses its purpose, meaning we're becoming so, the Chafetz Chaim writes this in his essay, Yisapi Yeshua, we become so sunk into the ways of the Goyim, so Golus itself is even losing its purpose. We're becoming drowned by the Goyim rather than being standing up against them. So then what happens is, as a situation very similar to what happened in Mitzrayim, we were floating, we were sinking down to the 49th level of Tuma, and HaKadosh Baruch Hu had to save us. So we are, in a certain aspect, coming so close to the end of the Gula that we're either going to sink or swim, right? If you can sink, that's terrible, right? If you're going to swim, that's great. So where does a person stand in these two ends of the spectrum of the spiritual service, the devotion, what we want to try and do to serve HaKadosh Baruch Hu? That's the question. So we have a couple of halachas here that's brought down in the beginning, very beginning of Shulchan Aruch, that a person should think about, right? And should mispalil al korban v'al golus harutzo. A person should think about and pray for the golus, and in the, that's in Siman Aleph, it's the end of Sif Beis. And Sif Gimel begins, Roy Lepol, Yerushalayim Shi Matzer with Goyeg Al Korban Beis HaMikdash. Every person who has Yerushalayim should have, right, a concern and a distress over the Korban Beis HaMikdash. So what does that actually mean? Svarim bring down the Shem and Shmuel, for one of them, brings down that a person without the Beis HaMikdash, he has a very difficult time to have what we call Yerushalayim. When you have the Beis HaMikdash, it's easy to have Yerushalayim. You go, closest brings down that you see the Beis HaMikdash, the Avoda, the Kohen doing everything there properly, and he wanted to become like them, and it was easy to acquire Yerushalayim. Without the Beis HaMikdash, we have very little outside influences that will help us achieve Yerushalayim. We have to do it internally rather than externally. So a person should pray on a regular basis on the Korban Beis HaMikdash, and hopefully by realizing how what it meant to him, it means to us, we can increase our prayers. So there's a minhag during the 3 weeks that many during Chatzos Hayom, they say the Tikkun Chatzos. There are many Svardim, as a matter of fact, more than the Ashkenazim, but it's common. You go to the Kaisel Chatzos, by the way, for the next 3 weeks, is going to be holding exactly at more or less 12:45. Right? I'm sure if you go to the Kaisel, you'll see many people davening, saying Tikkun Chatzos there, and then they probably daven into right afterwards as well. There are many shuls and Beth Knesset up here in Yerushalayim, and other places around Israel in the world, that they have a kavias, they have a special service for Tikkun Chatzos during the day. Aside from Tikkun Chatzos during the day, during the 3 weeks, there is a mitzvah, according to many, Tikkun Chatzos during the whole rest of the year. Sometimes you don't say it, sometimes you do. Those are halachas, we're not going to go to those pratim exactly right now. But it's a thing that we should think about the Korban HaBayis, what it means to us, what it means to Klal Yisrael, and it means to Kadosh Baruch Hu. And therefore, during this 3 weeks, we focus our attention on that. And therefore, many of the things that we're being noyeg, we're accustomed to do during these 3 weeks, and is that increases from Rosh Chodesh, and it increases from Shul Shohabo and from Tisha B'Av, is to increase our concentration on the loss that we're trying to feel and internalize. And therefore, if we internalize it properly, we can hopefully make it tshuva. That's the whole purpose of the fast of Tisha B'Av, all the other fasts, the person of the 3 weeks, to bring us to a situation of tshuva. So that's what we spoke about. Eliyahu HaNavi, we report down in the Medrash, 3 days before B'Yis HaMashiach, Eliyahu HaNavi is going to come to our Sinai, and for 3 days he's going to scream, Tshuva, it's the last 3 days, everyone has a chance. So we're trying to think what possibly could be, if it would be now, the 3 days begin, what could we possibly do? And you think, there's so much to do, what could we possibly do? So we know that there's such a Chazal, the Yerushalmi says, a person who's not misavo, who's not mourning over the Beis Hamikdash, he's not going to have the zuchus, he's not going to have the merit to have the joy of seeing the Beis Hamikdash rebuilt. Meaning, if it means something to us, so then the Kodesh Baruch Hu is going to make sure that we'll be there to see it rebuilt, because it meant so much when we didn't have it, so Hashem's going to do Mida Kedmin and Mida, that you'll see that you'll enjoy the Beis Hamikdash when it's going to be rebuilt, and therefore we can have a part in it as well. So Tikkun Mitzvos is a very easy thing that we can try and do, especially during the 3 weeks, which is a time to say Tikkun Mitzvos. And Pinchas Shulchan Aruch says every night a person should say Tikkun Mitzvos, and during the 3 weeks certainly say so. The Mechaber also mentions, as I said, about being concerned about the Beis Hamikdash. So if you think about what Tikkun Mitzvos really is, first of all, it's a collection of slichos, similar to the slichos that we say on a fast day, or during the week before Rosh Hashanah and the week, the 10 days of Tzorah Mei Tshuva before Rosh Hashanah Kippur. So they consist of slichos, consist of vidui, and consist of Tehillim. They're basically two parts, the Tikkun Rachel, Tikkun Leah, right? Rav Chaim Yosef Sonnenfeld, the Rav Rashi here in Yerushalayim, with the old Yishuv, he said there's ein shir in the Tikkun Pesach. And it explains what that means, meaning there's no minimum shir and there's no maximum shir. So if a person, for example, if a person wants to say Al Naras Bobo, he wants to say Shir Malus. That and only that, he's going to take the concerns. So a person doesn't have to say take the whole Tikkun Mitzvos. Really, it could, if a person says it fast, it could be said maybe 10, 15, maybe 20 minutes or half an hour. If it says people certain say with one, maybe perhaps more kavana. So that takes a lot of time. Maybe people don't have so much time to say that. So even a person, he's middle of the day, it doesn't have to be done exactly Mitzvos. There is a tremendous advantage of saying it exactly after Mitzvos. But if not, so it can be said even. The soaring bring down the poskim. If a person, let's say, for the nighttime tikkun mitzvos, so it's getting close to olas hashachar, right? And he woke up early. So he's thinking to himself, what am I going to do? And I woke up early. I don't want to go back to sleep. Right? What's to do? So you can say tikkun mitzvos, right? You can say tikkun mitzvos up to a half an hour before olas hashachar, right? So let's say olas hashachar, say 4 o'clock. So a person wakes up at 3:20, 3:30. He's not going to go to sleep. So he can say Tikkun Mitzvos. He can even say just before the Ol Hashachar, let's say it's 5 minutes before Ol Hashachar, so say Shira Malos. Just say Shira Malos. Do it the same Tikkun Mitzvos. That you're saying this because this is your way of expressing your grief over the loss of the Beis Hamikdash. Right? If you want to say it in your own words, that's also good. Right? If there's a you want to say the vidui, the standard vidui that's in the Siddurim or in the printed Tikkun Mitzvos, you can say that as well. And if you have extra time, you can say the slichos and the other tehillims, which are included in the nusach of Tikkun Mitzvos. But a person has the time to say it, so he has the time to do it. The question about what about Birkas HaTorah? A person wakes up in the middle of the night. Right? So there are some that say that since it's said Derech Tachnuni, we're talking about slichos and Tikkun Mitzvos is in the Pashkas, so the same getter is this, same category is this. You may not even have to say the Birkas HaTorah, right? Because there's a question, maybe you're going to go back to sleep, maybe you want to dive in 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock in the morning, right? So you want to, you know, you're up now 3:30, so you go back to sleep at 4:15, right? So there's a question, you say Birkas HaTorah, and you go back to sleep again, right? So in fact, there are some saying that you don't have to say Birkas HaTorah, so if you just want to get, you happen to get up and eat a drink of water at 3:30 in the morning or something like that, so instead of maybe just going back to sleep, hold yourself back, and say, hey, you know, I'll say Shira Malus to express again my grief over the korban, over the goats. It's a tremendous thing. During the middle of the day now, during these 3 weeks, we can add on before Minka or after Minka. It's a very, very simple thing. We don't have to, you know, become, right, as the Ramchal says, Tikkun Mitzvos is talking about during the whole rest of the year, not during the daytime Tikkun Mitzvos during the 3 weeks. So Ramchal and Derek Hashem says, it's because seated. That's the same righteous, devout people who are very highly spiritually motivated, and they're searching after ruchnius in a very serious way in their life in this world. But to say Shir Malas, the Alan or Zbolov or something like that, that's a very simple thing. And you can add on, as I said, if you want to add on. Agav, women are not supposed to say Tikkun Mitzvos. So if you want to go home and tell your rebbetzins about Tikkun Tetzayis is brought down in the Sfarim, women should not say it. It has to do with, because it's psukim and the women in Midas Adin, Midas Rachamim, so they don't say it at all. If we show our desire to have the Beis HaMikdash, that's going to be the first and foremost thing that's going to bring it back. What else could be? Hashem's waiting for us, right? If you think about where we are now, it was 3 days ago, the fast. So that was Yud Zayin B'Tammuz. These Yud Zayin B'Tammuz, one of the five things we are fasting over and doing tshuva over was because Moshe Rabbeinu came down from our Sinai and he saw that Kal Yisrael was involved with the eagle. He broke the lovers. Right? So these 40 days between Yud Zayin B'Tammuz and Yud Zayin B'Tammuz until Rosh Chodesh Elul, right? These are the days Moshe Rabbeinu was by Har Sinai, again 40 days, 40 nights without eating, drinking, or sleeping. And he was misfollowed to a Kaddish Baruch that he should not destroy Chalila V'chas, Kal Yisrael, save Kal Yisrael. Hashem said, I'm going to make a new nation from you. Moshe Rabbeinu said, no, if a tripod with three was, did not stand, Avraham Avinu, Yaakov Avinu, and Yitzhak Avinu, right? If that didn't stand up for more, then it's certainly not going to stand up. No, Moshe didn't want it. And you see the godless Moshe Rabbeinu, we would jump at such a thing like that. Yeah, we would be the father of a new nation to serve the Kaddish Baruch, but we wouldn't jump at that chance, right? So it's just a little bit an inkling of what Moshe Rabbeinu was all about. And he spent 48 days and 40 nights trying to save Kal Yisrael, which in fact he did. So on Rosh Chodesh Elul, right, he came down, and then he went back up again. He went back up again for 40 days and 40 nights to now receive Ruchasiyas, which was culminated in Yom Kippur. So actually, at the beginning of the next year already, that the process that began Yud Zayin B'Tammuz is that we're praying now, like just Moshe Rabbeinu, we should try and emulate Moshe Rabbeinu at least. That they were praying for the sake of Kal Yisrael, praying for the sake of Kaddish Baruch Hu's honor in this world, that by Tisha B'Av, hopefully we're not sitting on the floor and not fasting. We could change it into a Yom Tov if it's within our power. Kaddish Baruch Hu was watching and waiting, and if it was just a little bit of a time of Tikkun Tetzayis every day, you might be able to tip the scales. As the Chofetz Chaim brings down, that a person might be the Yayish from the Geula. I mentioned this many times, yeah. The person might say, well, look, you know, it's been such a long time in the Gula, and if those Tanoim and the Amoroim, they with their prayers and their Torah and their Gemilat Chassadim and everything they had, they couldn't bring it. You know, if the Rishonim, Rashi, the Ramban, if they couldn't bring the Gula, and if the Abroim, the Gomim, the Baal Shem Tov, and all the others, Rabbi Kiva Eger, plus the Sefer, right? The Chofetz Chaim couldn't bring it, so what am I going to do? What it means to me? How am I going to do things that they could never do with their tefillah and their mitzvahs? I can't approach what they did. So Chofetz Chaim says very simply, he says, look, he brings the mashal from the Eved that was in captivity, that you have to redeem it, right? So if you want to redeem the Eved at the very beginning of his servitude, you have to pay a lot of money. Right, but if you want to redeem the Eved at the very end of his servitude, you can pay it off with a few little pennies. There's only a little bit of time, and that time he's left is only worth a few little pennies. So I said, likewise, we're obviously at the very end of our time in Golis. And we can pay it off with a little bit of our friends, a little bit of our mitzvahs, a little bit of our disciples, which didn't have to be done, and it wouldn't have done anything in the previous times, because we need so much more to pay it for, pay back for it, and redeem us. So then we have it, maybe just a little bit of it, Al Nora's bubble, or Shir Malos, with a little kavanah that we're doing this for the same sake of a mourning for the Beis HaMikdash. Maybe that would do it during these next 3 weeks. And if a person takes it on, we nether during the rest of the year, that's very good. Now it's like the Tetzayis is 12, I mentioned 12:45 in the evening, in the more early morning, midnight. So that's a little bit early, but in the winter time, many times it's like 11:30 at night. 11:30 at night, and the way it works now with electricity and everything, we have lights blaring day and night, and night is day and day is night. So a lot of people are up at 11:30. During winter time, it's very easy. And the person puts in a few little extra moments before he goes to sleep, and it's usually after Tetzayis. So it's not a difficult devotion at all. When people used to go to sleep soon after sunset, right, 7 to 8 in the morning, in the evening rather, and they would have to get up and wake themselves up, and usually without alarm clocks and all those type of things, So that was an avoda. So speaking of avodim with slichas, we mentioned about Rosh Hashanah. So the poskim asked, what if a person is saying tikkun katzayis, just to show you a little bit of what the shigus of tikkun katzayis is? What about a person has a choice? He only can say the slichas. We're talking about the slichas during Elul before Rosh Hashanah and Erev Yom Kippur, or tikkun katzayis. So it's a machlokas. A little bit of machlokas. Rosh Hashanah, many poskim in the Shari Tshuva and Rabbi Yosef say it's better to say tikkun katzayis. As they do it. Yosef Chaim Zonovitz, I believe, I'm not mistaken, he said it's better to say slichas. So what's going on here? So why would we think that slichas should be pushed away because of tikkun katzayis? Because if you look at the essence of each thing, when we're saying slichas for are we asking the Hashem should give us a slicha mikirin like a parah, Hashem should forgive us. We're asking for something for ourselves, right? When we're saying tikkun katzayis, we're asking for something for a Kadosh Baruch Hu, right? So in a certain aspect, you can understand it's better to ask for something for a Kadosh Baruch Hu than for ourselves. There's more lishma involved with it, right? And we understand that's the whole avoda of Rosh Hashanah. The whole avoda of Rosh Hashanah is we're mispalel for the kibud shem shamayim, that we expect and we hope and we want and we pray that the gula should come. These are the essence of Rosh Hashanah, that when we blow the shofar on Rosh Hashanah, one of the things we're remembering is that there's going to be a gula, and there's going to be a shofar sounded at the time of the gula shlema. And then we're hoping and praying that that's going to be something which is the whole world is going to participate in. So that's the essence of a prayer on Rosh Hashanah. So when we're asking for our slicha and mechila and kapora by the slichas, that's something which is not so mishma. But if you say tikkun katzayis, right, even the yechidus, and instead of slichas, that could be on a higher material because it's more mishma involved. So with this in mind, we can try and hopefully bring that to a little bit of an avoda, bring that to part of our lives. And again, I tried to point out that it's really not so difficult if you just take it on as in a minimal way. I remember when I first came to Scheinberg's Assembly, which I asked him, you mentioned when we're learning halakhas about tikkun katzayis. So I came with my siddur, and I said, Rebbe, well, what should I say? What should I say? So I support the here and there. He's going two or three different things. I'm very sure that the general rule is, if you say a little bit with kavanah, it's better than saying a lot without kavanah. So that's what Hashem really wants. That's what we lost when we lost the Beis Hamikdash. We lost our hearts behind the mitzvahs. And if we put our hearts into tikkun katzayis, just this one little thing, perhaps during these 2 months, we can take it on, be nether, and can continue afterwards. And then hopefully that'll be go a long way to bring the Gula Shlema.
Which Shirmal are you talking about?
The Shirmal, yeah, right by the Alanar bubble, the Alanar bubble, which is during the weekday. People annoy, some people annoy. Mishabur brings down on this halacha here, brings down that when people bench before they bench during the week or a day that's Takanun said, they should say Alanar's bubble, right? And during the Shabbos, so you don't talk about Takanun said, say Shirmas, Shuba, Shema.
So every Tikkun Katzos has the Shiramal, the kind we say on Shabbos.
Right, they have both. Right, the Tikkun
Alnor's bubble and
right. It starts with the Tikkun. The first Tikkun begins with Alnor's bubble, and the last one ends with the Shiramal Shuvu Hashem.
And it's at the start and morning, end up happy in a way.
So the whole idea is that we should feel that we've done a little something through our at least mentioning to ourselves, and Hashem obviously hears and understands that we're misabel for the lack of the basic English. That is one of the first sugyas in the Mor Brachos. Torah Shabbat Pet begins with this. This sugya, this is the beginning of Torah Shabbat Pet, right? The mice in there with Elianovi that we began talking about. This old Torah Shabbat Pet begins with this idea, this concept.
How do you put that together with the fact that the second basic English was destroyed because of Sinas Chinam? It seems if we say all the shiramalos in the world, but we don't recite the same as chinam, how could that bring the third base of mikdash if the tikkun has to be in avas chinam instead?
So I was speaking with someone about this point that the biggest sin as chinam is if a person can't be mevatet to somebody else, right? So especially something like this, like when you're taking away from your own time, if a person is mamayat, he lowers himself, right, to do something for a kadosh baruch hu, right, so he can transfer that to doing something for somebody else. So if you start doing things for Hashem, you can easily transfer that to try and do things for other people as well. And that's the beginning of vitronis, of being forgiving and going to help other people, and then not so caring so much about yourself. And therefore, if you do that, that will automatically dispel the sin of food.
Some people are very good with mitzvahs ben adam l'makom, and they're not so great with ben adam l'chavero, because it's easier to be nice to Hashem. He doesn't yell back at me. But to be nice to somebody who calls me names or who...
Yeah, that's the tremendous, the way she's talked about. And they say that the person, that we have to be mamla to Kadosh Baruch Hu, and we have to be mamla Ol Chaveru. There's such a mitzvah, I mentioned this before, I spoke to you once before about this at least, that there's such a thing as being mamla, as every time we say Kriya Shema twice, once in the morning, once at night, where mamla to Kadosh Baruch Hu give the kingdom and our acknowledgement of Kadosh Baruch Hu's reign and rule over us to a Kadosh Baruch Hu, and correspondingly, we have to give acknowledgement and accept the rule of other people upon ourselves as well. All malchus reveru. And when the verse instructor brings down, I'll pick out that there are four questions that a person is going to be asked when it comes to the first thing based in Shomayla. And one of the four questions is going to be, did you mekabel all malchus reveru in benachas? Did you accept it graciously, the all of other people, which is a very difficult thing. That's one of the most difficult things. You know, when you're by yourself, if you're, you know, you're learning Rashi, Tosfos, Gemara, you're by yourself, no one's bothering you, it's difficult, okay, you're davening Shmoneh Esrei. Every situation has its nisyonos, right? But the things, when the lightning is flashing between two people or a group of people, right, to keep your calm and composure, right, that's when you can really soar if you're successful, and sometimes you fail. But again, the person is not, as we mentioned many times by Koyrek, that the maxik machlokas, not to be maxik machlokas, the issur is to be maxik machlokas, to hold on to machlokas. You want to be mabat, you want to forgive. We make mistakes, okay, but let's see what we can do, let's see where I can fix it up, we'll try and correct it so it won't happen in the future, right? So you're not dwelling on the machlokas. Things happen, that's what it is between people. How can people remain married if they're going to hold grudges for what happened yesterday, 2 days ago, from the beginning, from the first night they were married? They'll never be able to stay married if that's the case. Because you have to be, that's one of the fine and gracious things that a kadosh baruch hu gave by giving people the mitzvah of piriyut, that they have to have a marriage situation, that they have to simply live together and work it out. Because if you're never willing to work it out, you can't grow, you can't shine, you always remain as you were. And again, we always, people are motivated by basically three things, kinya taiva recovered, or motzei yisal demin ha'oila, right? And a person doesn't work but to changing these things will remain as it was at the very beginning. So if we have the opportunity, that's one of the great opportunities of marriage, of interpersonal relationships, to work on these things, not to be involved with kinya, jealousy, taiva being jealous, and pleasure seeking and covered, trying to get honor and be better than somebody else. You work on these things, and the only way you can really work on these things is through interpersonal relationships and connections with other people. And again, okay, we make mistakes, but we go by it. Hashem's willing to forgive us for our mistakes, so we should be, we can make it easy, at least trying to be forgiving of other people for their mistakes.
So today we spoke about Tikkun Tzitzos at the time of Chit Tikkun Tzitzos, and we were Yotzi today.
As it should be for.
He helped us to be Motzi.
And here it's all as it should.
Does this have a card?
Yeah, there's a card in it. Let's see. I don't. I didn't.
Everything's just got. Mishoyas reshoyim, mishoyas reshoyim, kisoy, oyal tiroi.